wanted to talk today about, a little bit about what we've covered so far, and then talk about today's topic, which is going to be quantitative methods. Next time we're going to talk about qualitative methods. So this is kind of a good introduction to putting these two together, quantitative and qualitative, which you've heard so much about, and fits right in with our whole notion of program evaluation. But first, I wanted to kind of backtrack a little bit about some things that we've talked about that are going to lead up to what we're going to talk about today. By the way, when we talk about quantitative methods, it's kind of quantitative methods light in the sense that I don't want to get into a whole lot of the mathematics involved in it. I'm sure you're not interested in it yourself, but more the concepts of it, so that when you understand some of the techniques, we're going to talk about three quantitative techniques that are popular in program evaluation. And I'd like, from that point of view, to really, you know, look at the whole. I'm going to present it in a holistic way, not get too caught up with the details of it. But first, let's go back a little bit with some things that we've talked about that are going to fit in with what we talk about today. If you recall, we started with the history and philosophy of program evaluation, which was a bit of a struggle because up to that point, there was research, and we called it empirical research. And then ultimately started out with action research. I wanted to, you know, remind you of the kind of struggle that went on to really get to where we are today, which is program evaluation. And one was the notion that, research in the empirical sense was for theory, and that's the proverbial P.05 level. In evaluation, there was a bit of a struggle at first, as we talked about before, with empirical research trying to provide something for practical information about the effectiveness of programs in the real world, in typical settings. And the word that people came up with, or the phrase that people came up with, to try to take evaluation, take empirical research and put it into a concept of evaluation was action research. And my point was that they really hung on to the word research, but action meant, okay, we're not doing all these fancy empirical studies that are theoretical in nature. We're going to try to move it into the inner city where we're going to evaluate schools and so forth. So let's just put the word action on it. Some years went by, and they said, well, you know, action research here, that doesn't quite get what we're all about. Why don't we call it applied research? But notice that they hung on to the word research. This was before there was any evaluation. We're talking about the 1970s and 80s and on into the 90s. So applied research, well, that gave it a flavor of, okay, we're taking empirical research and we're putting it into the real world situations where there are programs coming from federal government, the Department of Education, all over, to try to change things, help people. Drug abuse programs, for example, school programs of all sorts. Then notice that time went by, and finally, these people who were doing this empirical methods, but putting them into very practical settings, decided to come true, so to speak, and say, well, let's just call it evaluation. Okay? That was kind of rough because, in a sense, as long as you hang on to the word research, people, you know, have a bit of respect for it. It's empirical research. It's really science. When you get into evaluative research, what's that? Well, the evaluators knew. But at this point, they said, okay, let's get the word evaluation in there, but still hung on to the word research. You can tell, you know, how prestigious the whole notion of research was at that time. And then finally, up to our present day, they finally came true to what was going on, probably the last decade, program evaluation. And what turned the tables here was they could not get values out of what they were doing. In other words, why were they doing this? Well, there was a community that valued something, or there was a company that valued something. And values in the research area you could imagine where it's fluffy. You know, we don't deal with values, we deal with science here. But values are all over the place in evaluation. The values, and even to the point where a lot of researchers didn't realize what instruments you use, what tools you use, what statistical techniques, they're value judgments too. In other words, you look at a situation and say, I think this is going to apply. Well, that doesn't mean there aren't alternatives than that. So the whole notion of values kind of got exposed for what it was, and there are values running all over the place in evaluation. You can imagine, you know, we got a school program, and daddy and mommy wants a certain outcome for their for their kids, and some other people want some others. So the notion of values is ingrained in evaluation, and finally we got the word program evaluation. Okay, so keep in mind that really where we came was a very slow progress from giving up some of the notions of research, which were very well suited for theoretical findings, were not very well adapted in terms of the tools and the methods and even the viewpoints for what was happening in evaluation. And we're bringing kind of research type notions down into real life programs. And at that time, federal government was giving money away all over the place to improve schools, to improve communities, to address drug addiction, all kinds of problems, which were always situated in the context of values. Clinical signs of change. Well, okay. What was going on? There was at that time a lack of specification of and focus on transactions. If you recall, transactions are those units of activity in the program that are connected with other units of activity that in turn have these enabling outcomes that then finally lead to what we now call the first order outcome, which is the outcome at the end of a particular program of one sort or another. Well, there was, at the time we had action research, applied research, evaluative research, there's really no notion of what it was inside the programs that actually created the outcomes of those programs. They were interested in the outcomes, and you can understand, outcomes is, you know, what we want is at the end of the program that these people get better. They didn't have any notion of what we now call, that was our first order outcome. They didn't have any notion either of the second order outcome. In other words, at the end of the program, you may have met your goal, but what happens 6 months later or six years later or whatnot? What was the follow-up? How long did it last? So that was our, we put together, together here in this class and earlier session, the notion of transactions, which produced enabling outcomes. In other words, enabling outcomes enabled other transactions or units of the program to do their part, that in turn led to first order outcomes, which in turn led to second order outcomes. Focus on global outcomes beyond the reach of the program. Well, that was a big mistake that I think both evaluators, but most certainly some researchers made. Global outcomes meant that there was some pie in the sky outcome. And, you know, the LBJ's example is a good one that I mentioned earlier. This was a case in which he put a lot of money in the LBJ administration into schools with the idea that at the end of it all, people would make more money, and then you make more money, you pay more taxes, and the government gets richer, and so do, you know, all these big outcomes are supposed to happen. The notion here is those were pretty global outcomes. It was a stretch, as you heard me say, I think, before, that, okay, a lot of money went into high schools, new science, for example, new subjects being taught, and so forth, which in turn might improve people's behavior and scores in college, which in turn might help them get a job, okay, which in turn might, you know, raise their income. All these things are probably fairly reasonable things to expect. But the extent to which this long chain of things was created by a particular program would be kind of pie in the sky. Yet the program was evaluated on the fact of okay, at the end of all of this, this was what was described as the outcome of the program. So we had, and I used the word kind of global outcomes. Global outcomes, those things could be affected by many things other than putting money into high school science or whatever it was by the time you get at the end of all that training. Now, it was very attractive to do because people said, yeah, gee, that sounds pretty good. People are making more money and they got a higher standard of living and so forth. And we want all those things, but the truth of the matter is the program was sold on those things happening and they didn't. Or it'd be unreasonable to think that they would. They might contribute to it in some respect. The lack of program context. A whole story is what I call it, constraints. The context is that environment in which the program sits in. Call it a community, if you will, a municipality, a school system, a business organization. That's the context. Now, when you have a program that's trying to change something within those institutions, the context is often very important as to the extent to which that particular program is going to work. Now, we know that the program has transactions in it, meaning, you know, they have different activities that are going to generate a particular outcome that you want. But to what extent are those activities and outcome affected by the environment, the context? And so we entered into our discussion, along with our other concepts we've talked about, the context. What is it out there? And I said, well, one thing is there's values and needs. If you get outside the program for a minute, or before the program was there, what's the needs? What is the capability, the attitudes of individuals, as well as the resources that you need to actually put the program on? And that's the that's when we use the word, there are constraints. In other words, the program comes into a situation where, in that context, there are constraints. And by constraint, I don't mean necessarily, even though the word sounds like it, something negative. It can be positive, too. It can constrain, and it can also make improvements in the program, make it go more smoothly, and so forth. So when you're evaluating the program, the outcome of that program is going to be influenced by the constraints. So that was our notion of the lack of program context in the early stages of evaluation. And finally, the lack of index of practical importance. We're all familiar with the P.05 level. You use it all the time in your dissertation and everything, and it says, okay, I could, this is significantly different from one treatment is significantly different than the other, but I could be wrong 5 times out of 100, okay? Think about this in the context of program evaluation. It 5 times out of 100, but it does not tell you how much the program actually worked, okay? It said that you beat the odds. Yes, there's a 5% chance I could be wrong, but think more deeply about it and say, that's a reasonable level to think of. There's nothing wrong with a P.05 level, but it didn't tell me what I want to know. How good was the program? And for that, now we had to get involved in other types of statistics, not just the P.05 level. Think about the P.05 level. It says, okay, I could be wrong 5 times out of 100, but how big a change did the program make? Okay, that's the difference. How big a change did the program make? I know you followed the rules of science and you beat the odds of probability, okay, if it was significant, but how much was it felt by the people who were in this program? Okay, we're going to get this program across the country, and so forth. There was no index there. If you just used the P.05 level as a scientific index, and you could write an article and get it published because the manager would say, okay, this was significant, but we don't know whether you want to put $500,000 into the program or not. So we're going to talk today about some other levels of assessing the effectiveness of the program, which you have heard about. For example, we'll say something about effect size. And we will say something about percent of variance accounted for. If you recall when I talked about the percent of variance accounted for, we're not talking about the P level now, we're talking about percent of variance accounted for and effect size, but for percent of variance accounted for, we know that, you know, if you're in a industrial business situation or you're in a educational situation, unless you count for about 10% of the variance, the people in that, in that environment is not going to notice the effect of this program. Now, you know, is it 8%, 9%, 10%, 11%? Could be, but it's got to be in that range. Why? Because we've been doing this for some 35 years now in evaluation. And what is our marker to tell us this? It means that people notice that there's a change in the program. That's what happened over 35 years of being in program evaluation, okay? They notice it, and that is an important element. In other words, if they don't notice it, then they know they're doing something that's not making any effect, at least as far as they see it, okay? And that, in fact, deteriorates the effect of the human service delivery people that might be working in the program. Okay, we'll talk about those things today, and particularly the important notion of percent of variance accounted for and effect size. Theoretical orientations. We did talk about, there's kind of the fog of war when you, I think you got that feeling, when you go into an evaluation setting, the fog of war means that what are you looking at? There's so many things going on. There's a human service delivery people, there's the managers in the program, there's the maybe parents of kids in the program, they're the kids in the program. Where do I kind of situate myself? If I'm an evaluator, where do I start? And I came up with four different kind of viewpoints that you can think about. One is the decision-oriented approach to evaluation, and we've talked about each of these, as you recall. And basically, the decision-oriented says, you know, what I'm seeing here, and as I look at the program, this is a good situation for determining whether we should have objectives. In other words, you write behavioral objectives, and if you write behavioral objectives, it's at the end of such and such, these people will do this at this level. Okay, so you have some benchmark that you're trying to achieve. That was the decision-oriented. And with each of these, I said, you know, when you come into that situation, which of these that we're going to talk about here is going to fit that situation? Is this a decision-oriented situation that we can use this? And we're going to lay down some markers as to what you have to look at to see whether it is best for decision-oriented. Not the least of which is people have to feel comfortable with writing behavioral objectives. You know, at this, you know, such time, these things will happen. Applied research. We're all familiar with applied research. It's, you've got a control group, okay? It's this versus something else, okay? Now are you walking into a situation where you can see that there's some alternative that you have under your control that you can use to bounce the effect of your program off of, in other words, the control, okay? Now you walk into some situations, as we've even talked about, there's no control. You can't withhold the information from somebody, okay? But a lot of times you have a control. You can create that control. That is our so-called applied research notion. If you're only an applied research person, you couldn't do anything unless you had a control. So do you have a control in a situation? That would be something that would pop up and you should notice when I say the fog of war. Say, okay, you know, is this a decision? Can you do decision? Can you do objectives here? Or you know, you walk into some settings and people don't even want objectives. Others, you have a control group. The value-oriented, which is our third. What's the value-oriented? Well, the value-oriented says that it is with what we've talked about already, which could be the decision-oriented applied research, you could add a value orientation to it. And a value orientation says what you, it, part of this program is created by certain values. And these I mentioned earlier, like could be constraints, things from outside the program, parents, human service delivery people, so forth, wanting certain things or not wanting certain things from the program. And the part of that evaluation has to include those values. Call them constraints, if you will, because you know they're going to influence the program. They're not part of the program. They're not making the outcome come better. But what they're doing is saying, hey, we have these kinds of issues, and their values. For example, parents. You've got a community with parents that really object to certain things or very like things a whole lot. And they're instrumental in, you know, contacting principals and people who are funding the program and so forth. Well, that's an issue that needs to be brought into the evaluation. What are the values? And we saw, you know, in our own little descriptions earlier that it is an important part in how to even look at it, you know, in our structured analysis and design technique, which we talked about a little bit and we'll come to next time. Systems. We talked about systems evaluation. So these are types of foci, if you will, that you walk in and say, to what extent is this a decision-oriented, applied research, or value, or combinations of those? Okay, do they exist? Is it possible to do that? Rather than go in and take a hammer and just start pounding on things, you know, say, wait a minute, I need the right tool. Okay, I need the right tool here, or a mixture of two. Well, our last one is systems, and we talked about that. Those systems are programs within programs. We have enormous bureaucracies, like TEA, Texas Department of Mental Health, bureaucracies meaning levels upon levels upon levels. And in fact, oftentimes people who do kind of the grunt work are on the lower floors. And then as you get up to the higher floors, then the people have a more holistic view of things. And finally, you've got the person who is in charge of the whole place up there on the top floor. It's not always the case, but anyway, it's an analogy. So now the issue is, what's the evaluator stepping into? He's stepping into a situation that could be that, you know, we've got this department downstairs that isn't working, okay? But because it's a system, it's hierarchical. Because it's a system, now it means, well, what things have to go on in the program in order to provide the information at a higher level for that higher level to do its job? And, or you can say, well, that higher level that produces something in the system that in fact is at still higher level. So what's the evaluation here? The evaluation is, okay, what's going on? We've got someone, some department in this large organization that's producing something that's necessary for the next higher level unit. It's a piece of something up there. And in turn, that higher level unit might be producing a piece of something for some higher level unit. Well, now the evaluator is looking at, hey, is this piece down here providing what's necessary up here? But you also remember how much I talked about, well, wait a minute now. Don't be fooled as an evaluator. It may be this piece up here isn't doing what it should be doing. In other words, the manager of the program says, you know, look at these people down here. We've got a lot of people here saying that this unit down here isn't doing, or these people are saying it up here, but they say, well, we're not doing the job because these people down here, well, wait a minute, it might be just the other way around. So the evaluator can get duped into thinking right away, okay, I'm going to study these, but you've got to study both of these people, okay, both of these units. And that was our systems orientation. And so that context is where programs sit within larger systems, meaning organizations, okay. Models. We introduced three different models, and I said, you know, I'm not really a modeler. A modeler would mean, okay, I for the rest of my life, I'm going to follow Provost's approach to evaluation, or Stake's approach to evaluation. Personally, I'm not really for that, because I think each of these contribute different parts, and it's a mix and match situation. Sometimes you come into a situation where some of the things Stake talks about in his model of program evaluation is great for some parts of the program evaluation. Provost may have some other ideas in his model that you can use. So mixing and matches and knowing something about each of these models can put approach to you together that works in a particular setting. What are each of these Provost statements? Stuff will be if I had to pick out one thing. Well, Provost talks about inputs, processes, and outcomes. In other words, he reminds us that there are inputs to programs, which are things that exist outside the program that are needed. Textbooks, materials, guest speakers, certain devices, whatever, are input. And then there's the processes, and his processes are enabling outcomes. In other words, things in the program that have to enable other things to occur in order to get to that big, wonderful outcome. And then there are the outcomes. Okay? And that was Provost's contribution. Stakes, we call logical contingency, meaning that do antecedents match transactions? The best way to describe this is you recall the story, okay, I'm on this person's dissertation committee, and he is getting a PhD in school management, basically. And it's the preliminary oral, if you recall. It's the one before the final oral where they question them to see whether they have everything they need to learn to finally do their dissertation. And if you recall that the committee of which I was a member, and I'm outside that department, so I was an outside person and not really one of the group that really trained this person. We're asking him certain questions, and they finally came to the conclusion that he, because he was doing a study of, collected data from 400 superintendents across the United States, asking them about their management policies as part of the dissertation. Well, if you recall, they said, well, you know, to do that, there's a lot of data analysis. I mean, you know, you have a big questionnaire and you have 400 people plus responding to it. True, there's a lot of data. Well, what you need to do then is take a Fortran programming course. Okay, and I'm sitting there, if you recall, and I didn't say too much, but I was thinking about it. And finally, I got my nerve up because I'm outside that department. I'm kind of person coming in from another department, being on their committee, and said, you know, you're going to be a superintendent. You're going to have people that are really going to analyze your data for you. I mean, you don't really need to learn Fortran, you know, to write programs. I said, even the data you have is pretty simple. You know, I mean, you don't have to write a program to it. You can go to SPSS or something like that. And if you recall, the people were shaking their heads, the other faculty, and they didn't like it, me getting involved in their decision making. And finally, when I convinced them, I said, yeah, well, I think they just convinced themselves that, yeah, you're right, that's probably overkill. But then they wanted to be sure that, you know, they kept their high standards up. He said, well, then you'll have to take a course in SPSS, which is not programming, but using a canned system. And they talked about that for a while, and then I got the nerve up and said, you know, you don't need the whole system to do that. You're just doing mean, median, modes, and, you know, correlations, aren't you? You know, I mean, you're not doing, you know, factor analysis or multivariate analysis of variance. No, no, just, you know, just descriptive statistics. Okay, well, I could see they didn't like that, but they kind of caved in a little bit. Not much, but then finally, it was probably the end of my relationship with these people, but I said, you know, do you have $200? Could you get $200? You remember? He said, sure. I said, you know, you can hire a graduate student in our quantitative methods program for $200, he'll do your data analysis, and you'll never have to worry about anything being wrong. That's his profession, you know. And they about almost threw me out of the, they didn't go for it, but it was a good example of what we're talking about here in terms of, you know, stakes, logical contingency. The contingency, the word contingency comes into play. What is the task you have to do? And what is the instruction or the transaction that needs to go on in order to lead to that, okay? To be a nice, perfect connection to it. And it was not one that, you know, individuals wanted to hear. They had a notion about making it kind of tough and meaningful, they thought. Stuffel Beam, context was his contribution, if you recall. Context is what we talked about just a moment ago. It says, what is outside the program that could influence the program? You know, constraints from coming on top. When we talk about, and you talk about, present your programs using my structured analysis and design technique in the next 2 weeks from now, you're gonna look at those kinds of things, meaning constraints, not inputs now, but constraints that come from on top of the program that are in the context. The constraint is something that's in the context that can constrain what you want in the program. And I'd also say even speed it up. I mean, you could have great support people out there in the community that may even contribute to the program. And so you may have others that may disagree a whole lot, at least some faction of them disagree a whole lot. Whoops, you got a constraint here. And if this program's gonna work, somehow you're gonna have to address, you know, the fact why these people don't like this program, or why they're maybe suggesting things in the program you hadn't thought of. Okay, so those were the models, a little bit of the top edge of what each of these contributed, or at least one example of them. Finally, objectives. Keep in mind, we talked about Eisner and Popham. Simple idea, but not always carried through very well. Focus. Eisner is, if you recall what we talked about with regard to Eisner, focus on thinking and organizing. There's two ways to look at outcomes. One is, you know, we measure this at the end of the program, and that's an outcome. Eisner says, but how do you get the outcomes? The most efficient way over the long run is I need you to think in ways that could help you generate that particular outcome, but not just that particular outcome. In other words, what are the thinking tools that you need? So Eisner is saying, you know what, if we just go all the time and just look at the outcome of it, the truth of the matter is you could be getting the outcome, if you will, use the experience, for sometimes the wrong reason, or not fully understand why you've got the outcome. If you have the thinking skills to it, now what it says is not only is the right answer just what somebody might say, but there may be some range of that outcome as a result of your thinking skills. In other words, you can apply those in different ways. So the idea of if you, you know, you're talking about critical situations and, you know, military or big companies and so forth, is that I would want someone to know, have the thinking skills that could get to that outcome before I would just teach the outcome, because that outcome isn't always gonna sit in the same situation, in the same context, okay? It's gonna fool you. So getting to the thinking behavior that could actually point to a range of appropriate outcomes, okay, is gonna be much more effective. Finally, needs assessment is what you remember we talked about, the Shaker Heights, Ohio school system. Current versus what you want things to be, and just, you know, remember that example. Okay, let me talk about some things. We're going to talk about standards and statistical models, but I'm going to do it in a sense that I'm not going to worry about the mathematics of things, but just the idea. So that's the purpose of what we're going to do. What started all this off was a lack of an availability of evaluation assistance and standards. You can imagine people, you know, being trained in one way or another across the country, trying to evaluate large sums of money that were devoted to very large projects. We have that now. I spent a year in Washington, D.C., working in the Department of Education. And one reason I was there is because they decided things aren't going too well with people that get these funds and do evaluations. So maybe we should provide some technical assistance. So when you get a large grant, and these were large, millions of dollars to states and municipalities and so forth, along with that should be the resources to help guide the individuals in that project how to evaluate the program. So they said, well, how are we going to do that? I mean, we've got a big country here, United States of America, they're giving a lot of money. They said, okay, well, we sat around and we said, you know what we need is national regional evaluation centers. That these are units that would be situated throughout geographically the United States, and we'd assign their area to a number of states. Basically, they were from about 5 to about 6, and I think in one case, 7. So the states were contiguous. They were close, they were connected with one another as much as possible. So there were 7 of them. They housed evaluators, okay, who they were screened and evaluated themselves in terms of their experience and so forth. and there were jobs. Okay, you go there and you are going to operate in that center. So anybody who got a grant from the federal government in that area could go to that technical assistance center. Okay, and you would be competent people in there to say, okay, we're going to give you some. They're not going to do the evaluation for you, but they're going to give you all kinds of technical assistance. And in some cases, they did some help with the evaluation themselves. But their job was to provide technical assistance. Okay. To raise the level of the evaluation that was taking place and to get better data as to whether, in fact, these large programs that were millions and millions of dollars in some cases, that the evaluation they were getting is true, that, in fact, we could really base decisions in Washington about, you know, are we going to throw more money in this direction or not? To what extent is it worth, you know, the $2.5 million we gave in this direction? It was to provide information. So those were the national and regional centers. As I said, there was a couple of slips there in terms of national center in Portland, Oregon. You know, it's adjacent to the Pacific Coast, and it's not that far from Hawaii. So Hawaii's a state. So it has, by the way, huge sums of money because Hawaii is not always the vacation place you think it is. It's seven islands with a lot of diversity in terms of poverty, drug addiction, the law. So they, meaning Hawaii, gets a lot of money from the federal government. So, of course, I had friends that were in these centers, and the only problem was that they have oversight committees in Congress, you know, people who kind of watch how the federal government is spending money. And as I mentioned before, I think it hit an awful lot of traffic between Portland, Oregon and Honolulu relative to the other centers, you know. And basically, you know, their little investigation was a lot of people were, taking the kids and the wife over to. But now they did have work to do there, but the truth of the matter is there are a lot more people going to Hawaii than probably should have been there. So there was some abuse in it. But at any rate, in the end, it turned out okay. Statistical models, which we're going to say a little bit about. These are, you know, I mentioned to you, to put this into context, for you to recall. You know, I was a Skinnerian, if you will, B.F. Skinner, guy who did all the advice, okay, and I was analyzing his data as a graduate student, and you know, I believed in the empirical method a whole lot because this was animal research and basically doing things that were like fixed variable reinforcement and so forth, and was kind of a true believer in very pure research studies of that type, and. It was, you know, and I was in my second to last semester of my doctoral degree, in which case I ran out of money, and I, BF comes to me and says, these people over in the College of Education just got a new grant, and this was the one about the, poverty grant in the East Coast, and could you go and evaluate these people? And I did. I said, no, I don't want to do this. This is just a bunch of fluff because I'm an experimental person. I'm a statistician. You know, and this data just didn't make sense to me. They started the program without any pretest. They had no control group. You know, and the more they would tell me these things, I said, you know, there's no way I can ever do that. And for ill or good, I now found myself in such a situation where I'm now going to show you, at least to the extent that we can in the time we have, that how you can actually deal with these difficult situations, okay, because they turn up in evaluation all the time. And we're going to talk about three different approaches, the norm reference, model, the regression projection, and the group comparison model. Now, those titles don't mean a whole lot to you, but what they are the they're ways in which an evaluator can get through an impossible situation. And you know, it was only by going over to the College of Education, which I didn't want anything to do at the time, but in facing these difficult situations. By the way, I didn't solve them. That became later, but I kind of walked my way through that situation. But I did later look back at it and I said, you know what? I'm dealing over in the psychology department with things that are pristine. They're rats, okay? They're mice, basically. I had total control over them. You know, if I didn't get the effect I wanted, you just give them more of the injection of something or give them more feed, you know, certain nutrients and so forth, you know. But now I'm in the real world and I didn't appreciate it. I didn't do a very good job, and it was there just because I needed the money, but I got through the job because they had no pretest, they had no control group, you know, and I remember going over there, I said, these people are crazy, you know. I said, how could you do anything like that? But then I went ahead and did the best job I could. Well, that's just a prelude to the kinds of things that now I'm sitting here, and it's quite amazing that now that's all I do, basically, try to do the impossible, because you're out in the real world and you don't have those things. Now, it isn't that you don't always not have them, but the truth is that you run into situations, which you don't. Okay, so now, why are these three created? The norm reference model, where there is no control group, okay? I'm gonna just give you a little light discussion of what the evaluator does. No control group, okay? A second is called the regression projection model, and that's when the pretest scores are not available at post-test time. Okay. Well, in other words, you can see this is real world in the sense that you get a pretest, but not everybody shows up at the post-test. Now, you know, there are going to be some people that are going to show up, but you might lose a lot of people for one reason. Maybe, you know, they didn't like the program or it was too hard or whatnot, okay? So in the first case, we don't have any control group at all. So one could say, how can you make any decision on it? Well, you can look at the difference between pre- and post-test, but it leaves a big rival hypothesis out because you have nothing, no control, okay? You can say, well, the movement between pre and post-test, well, you could get that without the program. I don't have a no program to compare it to, okay? And with the regression projection model, it says, well, when pre-test scores are not available at post-test time, well, I don't have a full complement of post-test, so clearly I could be attacked, you know, criticized a fair amount for the study. Well, the evaluators run into those two situations, the norm reference and the regression projection all the time. And finally, the group comparison model, I'll just say a little bit about. When pretest scores are significantly different across groups, okay? Well, okay, you have a control and experimental, and now you look at the pretest of both of them, you'd want them to be not significantly different. In other words, otherwise, you've lost control of it. You know, say, well, one group, the experimental people, came in and on the pretest, they were higher than the control. Well, right away, you got a problem, okay, to deal with. Well, here are some statistical approaches that we'll just talk about briefly in each of these. But the takeaway here would be for you to know that there's the norm reference model. You're not going to be statisticians, and you're probably mostly you won't be analyzing data related to these, but you know, when someone mentions the norm reference model, you know what it's for. The regression projection model, you know what it's for. And the group comparison model, you know what it's for. We're also going to talk about interpreting the practical importance of evaluation findings. Remember, that's going to be the percent of variance accounted for. We'll say something about, and we'll also say something about effect size, which are ways of actually making definitive decisions statistically about different programs. Just as a reminder, next time we're talking about qualitative. Then we have our two presentations in a row. And next time I will ask who is gonna be in though, you know, what you wanna volunteer for. We have nine people, so there's gonna be three the first day, and then the second will be the other three. And then they're gonna be instrumentation and scales I'm gonna talk about. outcome evaluation, and then instrumentation and scales, and then presentation. This is our last class, next to our last class day presentation. Three, okay, so now that's our 7th, 8th, 9th person, and I'll ask you, you know, which one you want to, what dates you want to present. And our last class day, I'll be in my office for individual consultation, because at that time you will have done your structured analysis and design technique. You will have those diagrams for me. You'll also have an opportunity, of course, to redo your part one of the paper. You can ask me any questions about part three of the paper, which we haven't gotten to yet, but we'll be there. Okay. A couple of a high aerial view of the non-referenced model. What are some of the ingredients of, well, one, how do I get through that situation where, you know, when it's unethical to withhold treatment or the inability to select groups with comparable backgrounds? In other words, what can you do when you don't have a control group? Well, one is to give the program participants your unnormed group. Norm tables are pretty existent across all sorts of different behaviors and outcomes. For example, a criterion reference test. And a matching norm test, and create a lookup table. In other words, you're gonna have an unnormed test, which would be the definition of a criterion reference test. We don't have a comparison. And then the matching norm test. So if you had those two, you could put them together and decide whether, in fact, the treatment exceeds the norm. One approach. A second would be develop your own norms over successive program cycles. The norms are going to tell you, you know, to what extent did this program actually improve people's lives. And those norms are going to be in place of the control group. You're going to develop those over successive program cycles. And the reason I say that is because you need enough people in your norm sample in order for actually to bounce your results off of. And one cycle of the program might not produce enough individuals, maybe even the second or the third. But generally speaking, in the second or third, you're starting to get enough that you can actually use those norms then to decide, you know, to get an index of the effectiveness of the program. Look for a standardized norm test with subgroup characteristics close to your own group. Well, it's interesting that what has happened with individuals, municipalities, schools, and so forth that use that do testing, particularly schools, at all levels, that there are different subgroups that, if you have a norm, you want that norm table, let's say, how do people perform in a certain area, it's going to be connected to a certain type of individuals for which you got those norms. Now, does the subgroup that you have, that you want to study, does it fit the population that you have? Well, in this case, you've got to test, you're going to look for those individuals, and it's going to be a way of taking that subgroup norm. Now, what has happened in the area of publishing is that people that are using a particular test are getting so upset that in fact, because we have such diversity in the country, that test isn't really going to represent certain individual groups. In other words, what you're doing is putting all the individuals together across the country with all sorts of, some are, you know, have all kinds of problems, some are in different programs, some are more advanced than others, and that's a problem. So now, the publishers want to sell their test. So now what they do is create tests. They have subgroups. In other words, this is information that we collected on this subgroup, and this is information we're using for norming on another group, and so forth. And those groups are ones that normally, you know, kids with maybe disabilities, okay, or some disabilities, or kids with certain backgrounds. So the norms now are those norms that are gonna fit those particular kids. And that's how the publishers have now gotten out of a really bad situation some years ago where people stopped using them because they felt it didn't fit their clientele, you know. We're in a poverty school district here, and you're giving these norms are, you know, for kids all across the United States. In which, well, they just then would said, hey, let's go create norm tables for those. So always, they're available. And then finally, find a sample like yours, another program, in other words, that has taken both your unnormed test and a matching norm test. Well, here is what you're doing is you're saying, okay, if someone else, I have an unnormed test, but someone else is doing the same thing I'm doing, okay, I can go have a lookup table that in fact then improves my, I can go and use that because I'm gonna find a sample like, now it has to match up mine, you know, it has to be the same kind of people that are doing, and that often happens because the government gives money away in funding cycles. In other words, there may be 10 programs all of the same type across the nation. So in some cases, you can find that other one and just compare your students with those norms. Well, those are some of the ways that you can deal with it. If you wanted to see a kind of graphic description of it, let's just take a hypothetical situation. We have norms for 8-year-olds and we have norms for 9-year-olds. We have a raw score and we have a standard score. A standard score is just the raw score put on a larger scale so that instead of just dealing with the fourth grade, it'll handle the third, the fourth, and the fifth. So it's a stretch scale, so to speak, so they don't have to have different tests for every grade level or every age level. And then finally, there's a percentile rank. So in other words, if you get a score on this test, 25, this is your percentile rank. So for example, let's take Johnny. Johnny's pretest score at the start of the program that has been equated with a norm reference test, it's 20. This, again, is just a stretch scale to include other grades around Johnny's. And this is the percentile, okay? Now, let's just jump a year where the program goes through, let's say, a year, and now, with norms for 9-year-olds, okay? Well, what we would expect that Johnny, because he's a 9-year-old now, his score, raw score, would be 30. Again, there's a standard score, and his percentile rank would be 78. He didn't change. He did increase, but so did everybody else. So his score is 78 now. If Johnny's actual post-test score was 35, and the program, and here's the program provided this, the program didn't provide this. This is Johnny's score. He improved 5. Now, what I'm saying is that the program worked, okay, and now Johnny increased as a part of that. So now, the effect was a 5-point difference. Now, so and of course, you do this for everybody in the group. And to see whether the fact that program worked. So conduct an ANOVA between the expected and the actual post-test scores, and you'd have statistical significance as a result of it. So basically, what you're saying is you're gonna compare Johnny's movement from 8-year-olds to 9-year-olds, and if you didn't give the program, then it would be his percentile rank and everything would be the same. If he did improve, let's say there was instead of a 30, he got a 35, and that was the effect of the program, versus, what if he didn't do that? It was 30, he'd got a 5, and so you do it for everybody in the class and find out whether it was significantly different or not. What's the kind of takeaway with this? Strength, when a control group is not available, this model provides a plausible estimate of the level of performance that program participants would have achieved had the program not been provided. So using norms instead for a comparison. So norms would be, you have to get to a norm table. So it would have to be, if you're thinking about it, you'd have to get a test. They have to use a test that has norms to it already. The weakness, it would tend to estimate program effects for special populations. In other words, what if you were outside the case in which they did denorming on? You know, they did denorming on just average kids in fifth grade or whatnot. But if there's special population, assumes a norm group has some characteristics as the program group. So it has to be a match. It assumes the program outcomes can be measured satisfactory with a norm reference test. And the test is simply the mean of the obtained post-test scores and the mean of the expected post-test scores. You have both of those. This is the normed data versus the non-normed data. Any thoughts? The idea here with the norm reference is one, for you to recognize what you're doing is you're determining the effect of the program with norms. And you're saying, okay, to what extent I'm using a norm reference model, I'm using norms to look at the difference between one program versus another program. I wanted to probably, before we take a break, say something about our second one, which is the regression projection model. What kind of situation does this fit? This fits the situation. What can you do when pretest subjects are not available at post-test time? That certainly is a situation where, you know, people do drop out of programs. Without getting into the statistics too much, it uses actually what you know of regression. Let me just put it in a little bigger context. The state of Texas received, as do all states, not all states that have migrant workers, but they receive large sums of federal government if you're a state that has migrant workers, because. And Texas is one of those. Texas and Michigan are the two largest. And the reason they get large amounts of money from the federal government is that these migrants come at certain times of the year, basically for about 3 months. In Texas, it's about 3 months. And then they move to Michigan or some other states, okay? When they have kids, and so when they come, they want to put their kids in school. So I don't know if you've been down in the valley at all, but if you drive on some of the highways, you'll see these one-room schoolhouses. They're like fabrication. You almost put them on a truck and move them around, okay? Not part of a regular school, but there's school boxes almost, you know, there. So that in the time of the year that South Texas, you know, grows vegetables, basically, they come and they have to be in school. Now, each of these schools have a migrant worker officer that is also paid by the federal government. And that migrant worker administrator has to assess that the students that are coming to school are from migrant workers, okay? That the parents, there's some migrant worker information in it. Well, she or he is called the migrant officer authority, okay? And the state of Texas went and didn't check to see whether the data was accurate in terms of how many migrant workers and how many children they had that were basically in the school. Because they were checking up on, is the money correct? You know, they would give them millions of dollars a year to do this. And they found discrepancies between the migrant officer, what she or he recorded, and what their group found out. And it was kind of a superficial type of look through, but they looked through and they said, and actually they came up with the figure that the state of Texas owed the federal government $25 million because over a number of years, they had miscalculated the number of migrants that were there and the number of children that were in the schools. Okay. The state of Texas didn't want to stand for that and said, you know, we'll go to court because we don't think that that's the case. And so the federal government then said, okay, we're going to hire people to come down and do a thorough check of who, what kids, were they really migrant workers, and how many kids did they have, and how many did the school record, because the school was getting a lot of money. Schools, you know, it wasn't just one school. And the idea was that that they would, they hired a group in Dallas, Texas, that was, they really did, the group, they do door-to-door surveys, basically. It was a company, you know. They had never really done anything other than that. And they hired them to go down and now check to see what reality was. So they had about 10, 12 of these people went to all the schools in South Texas that got migrant money. They found, you know, a lot of these discrepancies that they thought that, you know, the federal government should get some money back on all of this. And Texas really fought it. And finally it went to court, okay? Now, I was involved in the sense that the state of Texas didn't know what the truth was. And there was myself, but there were others involved in this too, so it wasn't just me, to go and see, you know, how did they collect the data, these people from Dallas, how did they collect the data? Well, you know, I'm not arguing for either side, but there's pros and cons of this, but the first thing I noticed was that the people they hired in Dallas had to speak Spanish because they had to go to the parents of these people, okay? But there's a difference between Texas Spanish and if you were a college student taking Spanish in your classes, okay? And in fact, there's quite a bit of difference. It was actually literally shown in the courtroom where this was happening. So one was the state of Texas was trying to argue that the data wasn't good data that they had collected, you know. And one reason was that, you know, the communication may not have been very well between these. Now, this is true. So we documented that, and it is true that there was, you know, a significant difference in language, although they could communicate at some level. Another was, so first of all, I think the Dallas company made a mistake in hiring these type of people instead of hiring, you know, people, they are all Anglo people coming down that basically, you know, learn Spanish in a classroom someplace. The other was they rented cars for these people to come down and go to all the different schools. So there are quite a few cars. But they rented it and got a price, I guess, on these cars. They were black, like they looked like limousines almost. They were black with kind of shaded windows for the Texas heat, you know, muted windows and so forth. And they came down. So now these people are driving down to South Texas. They're then getting out of their cars, going to, and they now have people who don't quite match up in terms of the language, and all of a sudden, when anybody sees the cars coming, these people are running away. You know, they didn't, I mean, first of all, the whole idea of, you know, somebody coming up in a big fancy car down in South Texas and then gets out and doesn't have the right, you know, accents and so forth. So that was the condition under which the data was collected, okay, that they reported. So whatever the truth is, the end of it all was that this was in federal court, that they dismissed the suit, and consequently Texas didn't have to pay the $25 million. They settled for $2 or $3 million. They finally said, you know, we owe us some money, and they did do that. Well, that's the case in which you're looking at a situation that is, you know, very difficult to study. Now, a case in point was this a regression projection model. If we took, and there are programs that they did in South Texas, which they had a control group that they were studying, and they did not qualify for the program. They were trying to decide the effectiveness of migrant kids in schools. And they didn't qualify for the program. So there is a group of individuals that fit here, which is the cutoff score was high, meaning that they knew too much. They didn't belong in this particular program. They had better English, basically, and better scores on things. Okay. Then there was another group that qualified for the group. Okay, this was the group that should have been, you know, in the migrant worker program. They qualified. They said, okay, they're at this particular level. They speak this this language. Now, the idea was, how are you going to look at the difference between these two? Well, this is the regression projection model. If we found these data here, and if we projected it downward, now we don't have data here, okay? But if we projected it down here, and then looked at the difference between these two, we would then have a way of looking at the difference. Now, these are not, you know, very real numbers, but we have to go and look out here. Low, this is the post-test scores, because these were the pre-test scores. Here, look at the post-test scores and look at the difference between there. And we would get a score that basically would give us some index. This is the testing, the difference between the control and the experiment at post-test time. But, you know, we didn't have data here, but this was a regression projection model, okay? And one could argue that this has to be a straight line here is the way it was here, and we don't know that, but the idea is it's a linear here, and the assumption is it's linear there. That was the analysis of the so-called migrant worker program. And so basically, what can you do when pretests are not available at post-test time? Well, it's the regression projection model that in fact took these data, projected down. And this data here now, you couldn't do the analysis of variance. This is just a point on a scale. So you're just going to look at the difference between these two without, you know, having the data. Well, actually, you're going to project it out here and here and find the difference. So at any rate, the Texas, so help me, I didn't get any of the $2 million or whatever.
What year was that? Do you remember?
What?
Do you remember what year that was?
Yeah, well, no, I don't remember the exact year, but it was probably 8, 9, 10 years ago. So it was a long time ago. For me, it was a long time ago. I did want to finish because we are into something that's relevant to effect size. How many of you have heard of effect size? Okay. We're going to talk about two ways of looking at the effect of a result. One is effect size, the other is percent of variance accounted for. And you heard me talk about each of those. Effect size. Well, the effect size is simply going to be the difference between mean one and mean two divided by the standard deviation of the control group, okay, in a particular situation. Now, the point I want to make is that effect size is obviously the difference between two means. And the effect size is important because we know a lot about what the practical application of effect sizes are. Technically speaking, effect sizes are the average percentile standing of the average treated participant relative to the average control participant. So if you get an effect size of 0.8, and let me just give you an example, 0.5 and 0.2. 0.2 would be a small effect size. Now remember, the formula is very simple. It's the difference between the two means divided by the standard deviation of the control group. But now we can get to the p-level. In other words, what p-level would it be? Probability level. If you get a large effect size, you've got a very successful program, okay? And the percent of overlap, meaning that as I move this down, this is the experimental group, this is the control group, as I begin to move it, I have less and less overlap, I've got a bigger difference, and my effect size goes up. If in fact this moves over and just mirrors this one, then I have a very small or zero effect size. Effect size is a very efficient way of determining whether you have something that's worthwhile, because we know that the effect size of 0.8 is a large effect size, and it represents, roughly speaking, about the 0.01, if you want, you know, a kind of another value to kind of bounce it off of. And the medium effect size is somewhere between 0.05 and 0.01, and finally at 0.0, somewhere around 0.05 is a small effect size. Less than that, then you don't have a statistically significant finding, theoretically speaking, okay? Effect size can be thought of as the average percentile standing of treated participant relative to the average control. So a zero effect size would be, you know, no effect whatsoever. So effect size is not that difficult to calculate, and you can easily translate it into a p-level, like 0.01, 0.05, and so on. Finally, let me say something about statistical power, because they're related. And as long as we started to talk about it, let me just remind you of it. Statistical power involves three things. Your alpha level, and that's what we refer to as the 0.05, okay? 0.05 lows alpha level. Effect size. Well, I can now talk about effect size because we just said a little bit about effect size. Mean one, you know, versus mean two, divided by the standard deviation of the control group. Now we've got an effect. We know that 0.8 is a very big effect size. And then we have n. So there's three things for statistical power. Your alpha level, your effect size, and n. And if you're doing your dissertation, someone probably is going to ask what your statistical power is. And you want to know about it before they start snooping about it, and then you can't come up with it. And again, we said that 0.20 is a small effect size, 0.50 medium, and about 0.8. So statistical power. Here is power. And that's the ability to detect a significant finding if one is there. Ability to detect a significant finding if one is there. Or the probability of finding a significant difference if there is one. Now, here is the things that go into effect size. One is sample size, okay? That's certainly gonna affect it. And we also need to know you know, what the different levels of the power would be. And n is important. So we have alpha, we have effect size, and we have n. Now, what happens here? The point I want to make is what effect size, or we'll translate it now into statistical power. What kind of a statistical power do you need to be reasonable in terms of having a successful study? In other words, somebody who knows their stuff is going to read your evaluation report, and they're going to find out, well, what kind of power did you have to find a significant finding? Well, if you have about a 0.60, we're speaking about power now, to about 0.80, it can be higher, but it gets very, very difficult to get powers at this height. Why would that be? What would be one thing that would reduce your ability to get extremely high power levels?
Your sample size.
Yeah, sample size. Sample size is the big one. Also, alpha would be, if you changed your alpha up to 0.01, it's going to be more difficult, easier if you did it to, you know, 0.10, but people aren't going to usually accept 0.10. Now, the power is important. Well, there was a professor at the University of Wisconsin, and he was doing a study that really caught the attention people all across the United States, particularly women, because it was, he was studying women that had certain kinds of mental distress versus those that didn't, and the kinds of lifestyles that they led and what led up to this. He did the study, and he did find some positive results that, in fact, his hypothesis as to what caused certain kind of mental stress was significantly different than the control group. But the thing that overrode this was that it was about it was held in the newspapers in the United States. I mean, because it's a hot topic, you know, among large groups of people. It was about eight months or so after this, it actually hit all the papers, and there was actually a newspaper guy who knew something about statistics for some reason, okay? And he said, you know, what kind of power did this guy have to do this study? And he wound up, and the power turned out to be about 0.30, okay? And it really turned the results of the study around in the sense that there was a bit of a contradiction here. He kind of found something that was either close or to statistical significance. I think it was close to statistical significance. And the power was low. Now, the question is, for you, when you do your dissertation, you better watch out, because if there's someone around the table who knows something about statistics and power, they'll ask you what your power was, okay? And in fact, you may not have a study. In other words, they should do this before you actually collect your data, because you can have the data there to do it. It says, how much power am I gonna have to get a significant finding, okay? It's best that you find that out before. And if you don't have the power you'd like, then okay, I need more N, okay? You're probably not gonna change your alpha unless you set it at 0.01, but you could move it back to 0.05, and you're better. You know, you might be over-ambitious at 0.01, but move it down. That's gonna increase your power, okay? And your N would be two things that you could do. So before you do a study, a member of your committee should say, could you tell me what your power is before we let you go out and do this, because you'd be wasting your time. And so we want enough power to do it. And of course, what is power? Well, you have control over that alpha, okay? You have control over effect size. You can calculate, you know how to do that now. And N, simple enough, put those together. And in studies that tend to be credible and that reach a high enough level of significance, it's really, the bottom end is about 0.60 power, and mostly in that range, up to 0.80, but I'm not, as you noted before, I'm not saying, you know, it wouldn't be good to have something higher than that, you would. It's just, it doesn't show up. It takes more resources. I'm really using kind of the college situation. How much money do you have and time do you have to do that? If you got a whole lot of money and a lot of time, sure, you can get higher power. But you know, instead of, you know, 80 people in your study, you have to have 800 people in your study to do it. Okay, that's a little bit about power. Now, the other thing, just leave you with here, what's the takeaway from all of this? Three things. One is the issue of how large an effect is on a dependent variable. P.05, what does P.05 mean? And basically it's telling you, you know, what is the size of the difference, okay? So a P level is a, you know, pretty legitimate way to, and we would be surprised if you didn't include it in your dissertation or include it in a study. Now, what else is available? Well, one is, we know that P level is one part of effect size, so effect size is the other. Effect size is the magnitude of the difference between means in units of the standard deviation. The nice thing about effect size is it can be used across different kinds of studies. It's gonna be stable, because if you get a 0.8, it's gonna be, you know, that 0.8 is gonna be the same for any study that you do. we can say that, for example, a large effect size would be, and I mentioned this just earlier, you said 0.8, that's a pretty large effect size, or 0.8 of a standard deviation, okay? 0.8 of a standard. Its effect size ultimately comes to units of the standard deviation. That's a big chunk of a standard deviation. The nice thing about it is it's stable. A standard deviation, we always know what the standard deviation is. You can use it in any setting, under any condition. So about 80% of a standard deviation, or you can have 50%, 0.5 is a moderate size. That half a standard deviation. So it's always in, the benchmark is a standard deviation. That's the nice thing about it. And when do you see effect sizes used most?
Meta-analysis.
Yeah, that's what it came into being, meta-analysis. In other words, I want to look at an array of different studies, okay, and see which one is better. But I have to standardize it in some way, even though those studies are different. So if I'm using pieces of the standard deviation is set, okay? That's the standard deviation under any condition. The standard deviation is the standard deviation. Now you're looking at different studies and you're saying, well, this person did it this way, this person did it another way. Which one should I choose? You want effect size. You want to make that decision with effect size, okay? Why? Because they have all different variances within these different studies, okay? And you have to hold them constant. Well, you hold them constant through the standard deviation. Standard deviation is going to be the same, whether it's this study, that study, or another study. So they're very useful in terms of deciding who I want to believe. In other words, what study should I accept in this area, okay? It's the effect size you want. Now, percent of a variance accounted for. You know of this is, I'm going to determine what percent of, and you know, it's simple, I'm going to square my result, and I'm going to get the percent. The percent of variation is not going to be as useful as the effect size, but it's very important in a practical setting. Percent is the percent of 100, okay? How much control, how much uniformity do I have in this? How much did my experimental group exceed my control group? What's my effect? That's percent of variance accounted for. And it is in percent on a 100-point scale, 0 to 100%, okay? Simple enough. Now, the percent, why am I interested in the percent? You should be interested as an evaluator or doing evaluation because it tells us something that is in addition to the P.05 level. I kind of maligned it a little bit by saying, you know, the P.05 level is nice, but it doesn't tell us anything more than if I'm doing a study, in theory, this theory works. If I find something significant at the 0.05 level, I, by my own standard, 0.05, say it works. But I don't know anything more about it than that. An example would be, okay, let me go now use percent of variance accounted for. Let's say my percent of variance accounted for accounts for 10%. What would you say?
There's a significant difference between the treatment and the control. That the program actually makes a difference.
Well, no, I can't. The significant difference is one thing. The percent of variance accounted for is another. I was making the case that the value of this, the percent of variance come for, in a practical sense, is going to outweigh a significant finding, okay, of 0.05. 0.05, in theory, tells you that, okay, you found a significant difference. Okay? If I account for 10% of the variance, and you, did you remember what I said earlier in another session?
It actually shows up, like you're able to see that there was a difference.
Good. Now, in practical way of thinking, and in practical studies, it's the percent of variance. And what does it mean? you take a classroom and you've got kids in the classroom, and I'm observing in that classroom, and this teacher is using a new innovative method over the old method. And I'm looking at it, and I'm not as a researcher, just another teacher, say, I'm looking at it, and I'm saying, you know, this technique is a technique that actually helps in classroom management. I can see the difference that's made. Because I was here, or in another classroom, or earlier before this method was used, and I saw it this way. Now I saw it this way. It takes about 10% of the variance before it actually shows up. Now, it doesn't mean that there aren't good things happening if it accounts for 5% of the variance. There obviously are. You can't perceive it, okay? Generally speaking, in kind of group studies where you select people to come in to the study with different backgrounds, that is an important marker. Because now, not like the P.05 level, okay? All that tells me is, hey, you know what? I can get this published. It's a P.05 level. Everybody bowed down to the P.05 level. It has nothing to do with what people might see literally out in the real world, okay? In other words, is there a change with that P.05? Well, no, I'm not arguing against the P.05 level. I just want you to be sure to know what it is and what it isn't, okay? In evaluation, is that percent of variance accounted for? That's so important. And it's not anything nearly as scientific, if you want to call it that, from the P.05 level. What it is years of evaluators looking into classrooms, municipalities, studies of all different sorts, and saying, when do people in those settings really notice that they're willing to support this program, okay? And that's why the P.05, the percent of variance accounted for is so important, about 10%. Now, there's nothing magical. I mean, I think some people would see it at 8%. Some people might take 12% and so forth. But it's based on years of evaluators coming back and saying, you know, I don't get a response out of this program unless we have that amount of variance. And that's why the P.05 level is important. Okay, so we talked about statistical power. We talked about percent of variance accounted for. We talked about effects of it. Let's take a break. Last statistical model, kind of in the same light we did in the other ones. I don't want to bamboozle you with all of the statistics, but most importantly, the questions that we asked for each of these. For the analysis of covariance now, which is our last topic, we're really asking, pretest scores are significantly different across groups due to sampling error. If you could, we'll talk a little bit about the handout here in a moment, but what is the situation here? It really has to do with our differences. Analysis of covariance is adjusting something that, because of poor sampling, the difference, if you get the gist from the handout, was that, wait a minute now, analysis of covariance isn't going to work unless if there is an honest difference between two groups. What does analysis of covariance do? Well, let's just take the pretest. Okay, well, you're doing a study, and the scores for one group on the pretest is significantly different than the scores on the other. Okay, this is the pretest. Okay, they didn't get the treatment. Okay, well, are you in trouble or not? What would you? You have the pretest, then one is considerably different than the other. We might even say significantly different. Are you happy or are you sad?
You wouldn't want that, because you'd want all their background characteristics to be similar
right
from the beginning.
And there's two situations. One is that there are genuine differences between the two groups. The other is they're different just because of sampling error. In other words, okay, you had 50 in each group, but the truth of the matter is that they're not going to turn out to be equal. There's different people in those groups. The score ranges could be different, but it occurred randomly. The differences are randomly, okay? the alternative is that there are real differences there, okay? Now, if there are real differences, which is what part of the handout is trying to say, there are real differences, then this nice little technique that we call analysis of covariance, which makes everything happy and the same, isn't going to work. We're violating some really issues here. So what do we have? Well, this analysis of covariance is usually used because you're doing a study, such as your dissertation study, and you have two groups, and you have pretest and post-test, and on one of the groups, the pretest seems to be pretty large, if not significantly different than the other one, okay? Your first reaction, if you didn't know too much about your statistics, is that, oh, well, I can go use analysis of covariance that makes them equal, because that's what analysis of covariance does, okay? Make them equal. But what you did is, wait a minute, the truth is that there really is a difference. Analysis of covariance can't be used in that situation. In other words, you're covering up a difference that deserves to be a difference, okay? The reason for covariance is that if there's sampling error, in other words, there's not a real difference out there. It just happens that, you know, you may have, for example, 50 in one of the groups and 30 in the other. Okay, well, that could upset things a little bit and say that, okay, you're looking at the pretest scores and they're different, okay? But you can make the case that, wait a minute, they come from the same population. As opposed to, there's a significant difference between those. And one way to do that would be just simply even to test if there's a significant difference. I don't mind you having a difference between them, but if there is a significant difference between them, it indicates that they come from different populations. That would be the definition of a significant difference there. They come from different populations because it is statistically significant, okay? Now, the case in our, just to say a little bit about our case study here, which was a real event, as you can tell. Here was a doctoral student whose committee I was on that was in the Air Force and was going to go back and be in the Air Force. She's getting her PhD. And her first reaction was that she could simply use analysis of covariance because there was a difference between the men and the women on her pretest. I said, I'd get in trouble for all of this too, but you know, I said to the committee, I said, she can't do that, use analysis of covariance. And the committee didn't quite understand it. Why can't you? I said, well, it would, and I don't know why this came into my head, but you know, it would be like saying, can the ants beat the elephants if they were the same size? Now remember, there is a significant difference between the two groups, men and women, on the pretest, okay? So I felt justified in saying, can the ants beat the elephants if they were the same size? Well, okay, what did I mean by that? And you're right, they just stood there and stared at me like, you know, what are you talking about? Analysis of covariance can help you out in a situation in which there is not a significant difference, but there is a difference between pretest of group one and pretest of group two. That's what analysis of covariance is for. So that part you need to remember. What transpired was an interesting discussion about analysis of covariance. It assumes that scores on the pretest are random in the population, okay? And the translation would be they're not significantly different for your particular study. So when I say, can the ants beat the elephants if they were the same size? Well, wait a minute now. Can the ants beat the elephants if they were the same size? Well, what if the ants did beat the elephants if they were the same size? Well, first of all, you shouldn't believe it, okay? The answer to this is, okay, remember we have one pretest for your experimental group, another pretest for your control group. We know that there's a difference, okay? And we have, and they're men and women, basically, is what they are, okay? Now, what's the solution to this problem? And it may not, it may seem a little counterintuitive to you. Here we have the women or the men higher than women higher than the men, or vice versa. Now, what? Why don't we make them equal, okay? And then go and do our test. Bring the women up to the men. Okay, basically that was it. The men were scoring higher than the women, which is the problem in the first place. Bring the women up to the men, not the women versus the men, okay? Now we could go ahead and say the fact, if there's no difference, now what are we looking for? At the end, no difference, okay? That's a little bit counterintuitive, because when you do a statistical test, you say, well, there should be a significant difference between this. No, in this case, it's certainly valid. Say, there is no difference. You know, if you do your test and there is no difference, that's what you want, okay? If you follow the story, basically at the end, that's what you do. So I just ask you to keep that in mind, because it is an egregious fault when it occurs in the literature, and it does occur, that people have to realize that, in fact, that you can't change things that are there, inherent, okay? And the truth of the matter is, the men did score higher. Sorry, they did. And, you know, whether it's valid or not, I don't know, but, you know, they did. In terms of our statistics, there was a significant difference, okay? And the solution to it would be to bring, to equal those scores. But you can't do it by simply testing the difference between them. I have to assume that they would be equal, and then see if there's any difference. That's a little story about analysis of covariance, which you saw, which that is just an example of. I'm not going to go into all the details here, but first of all, under each of the things we talked about today, the norm reference part of our discussion, and I gave you a little thing underneath each of it that just simply identifies what it is for you with your dissertation defense or whatever. Pretest scores are significantly different across groups due to sampling error. That's what we're talking about today. And that's comes in with analysis of covariance. In the end, you're just looking at the difference though between them. You can't use analysis of covariance in that sense. Now, what does happen when, in fact, your pretests are different, but there's no reason to believe that there's a significant difference there, okay? But there is a difference. So what analysis covariance is now made for is when there is no significant difference between them. In other words, your assumption is the difference is from sampling error, okay? Sampling error means the problem is with your sampling. It's not the problem with what's true out there with the individuals, the women or the men or whatever two groups you have, okay, with that. So what does analysis of covariance do? Just very lightly, here would be your two groups. And this is a regression equation, post-test and pre-test, okay? This is the relationship between pre-test and post-test. And this is the relationship between for the control group. This is for the experimental group, okay? What analysis of covariance does, even though you don't see it, it's inside the computer, it's going to draw a line equidistant between these two, okay? And then it's going to now take the difference between each of the data points on each of these and fit it to this common line. And that's called the common slope. And basically, that's how it adjusts. In other words, it's adjusting each of these to a common slope. And what that means is that, hey, we know there's no difference between them, no significant difference between them, but we do want to compensate for the fact that one is higher than the other, okay? But it shouldn't be, it's just sampling error. So what it's really saying is, yeah, it's sampling error. It's not theoretically different, okay? There's no substance to the difference. It's sampling error. So we can do away with that and not feel guilty. You know, in other words, I can say, let's just even them up, okay? and then get on with our experiment and look at the post-test. Okay, let's even them up so we don't have a confounding variable like, oh, there's differences on the pre-test. That's how you got them on the post-test. He said, no, I used analysis of covariance, okay? I used analysis of covariance. That then assumed that there's no difference between them, and that's what you believe because that's what the test said. Now you look at the post-test and see whether there's a difference between them. So that's kind of, you know, this kind of overview of what analysis of covariance. One other thing I wanted to mention, though, with what we're talking about, is what's called aptitude treatment or trait-treatment interactions. They are very important in the sense that let's take a pretest and a post-test, which is what we're talking about here. I'm down here at this part now. And one is a group that, one group here and another group there. What happens here is if you do the analysis of these slopes, and instead of looking like this, they look like this. In this case, you have two groups, this group, this group. In this case, we have one group here and one group there. There's an interaction, okay? And in fact, your test could easily tell you whether it's significant or not, an interaction, okay? Now we take the same example before. There's a difference between them, and you're now going to use analysis of covariance. But in this case, there's an interaction. What can I say about that? Is it something useful, not useful? Is it something astounding that I shouldn't pay attention to, or what? We have two treatments. This is treatment one, and this is treatment two. And I said, you know, I want to find out whether one is better than the other. You do your analysis of covariance, and you get this. What's your conclusion?
That the groups responded differently to the same treatments.
Good. There's an interaction, okay? Now, sometimes you didn't plan on that interaction, but you analyzed the data, and this is what turned out, okay? In which case, there's useful information here. What it's saying is that this group here, this group is high on the covariate, and this group is low on the covariate. We come over here, it's just the reverse. What it's saying is that one treatment works this way, the other treatment works another way, okay? Group regressions are significantly different. There is an aptitude treatment interaction. What it says is that, okay, you know what? I want to put people in this group here. High covariate, let's say this is your high here. Now these people are low, and this treatment worked really well for these people here. Now, what did this do to people? Well, it's your choice. You're gonna choose people over here, okay? This is saying, wait a minute now. If you're low on this covariate, you're gonna be high on the post-test. Here, if you're high on the covariate, okay, you're gonna be, but you're at this end now, the high end, you're gonna be high in the covariate. What is the practical implication of this?
You would need more than one treatment to...
Right. I'm gonna put these people in this treatment and these people in the other treatment, okay? That's called an aptitude, could be aptitude trait, aptitude treatment interaction. So you went and did analysis of covariance because you had one pretest score higher than the other. And you look at your findings and you find this. It's possible. Okay, you find this. And you say, oh, what, this is terrible. What is this? Wait a minute now. What you really found is an interaction. Call it an aptitude or trait treatment interaction. And there's nothing lost here. You just found the world is more complicated than you initially started out. okay? It's as simple as that. It's a little more complicated. Well, what do I do with that? Well, obviously, I'm going to put these people in one group and the other people in the other group, okay, according to this. Because this is high, and this is low. This is low, and this is high. A covariate, that's the covariate. But where am I going to put these people? If I, in fact, think this is high here and this here, and these people do really well in this group, and those people do well. And then these are different groups. These are different people. Okay? It's called an interaction. Or we can use the word aptitude treatment interaction or trait treatment interaction. You don't have to do anything to search for this. If you did a test for analysis of covariance and you got this, you didn't get what you probably expected, but the truth is it's valuable information. That's my bottom line. It's called an aptitude treatment. And why? You put these people deserve this treatment, these other people deserve that treatment. Your treatment is not universally good for both of those groups. Okay. Yeah.
Yeah. Is it possible points at point B, we have individuals who were high on the pretest and low on the post-test. Is that really possible? Because if you already knew about a subject matter beforehand, is it possible to know less of subject matter after?
It is possible. Yeah, you did something, you know, unusual to create that, but was that your? If I'm understanding you right.
I'm just wondering, as if someone scored a 95 out of 100 in the pretest, is it possible to score a 30 in the post-test?
Score lower?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
The reason for it would be, you know, you'd have to, you know, use some kind of logic as to why that occurred. It's not what you expect, but it could be the treatment was so disarming and so painful in some respects, you didn't respond normally to it as you would. Yeah.
So are the two groups that you're trying to standardize in the ANCOVA, are they both treatment groups? Or can one be a control group and one be a treatment group? And if one is a control group, then how does this
apply? Well, sure, there could be a control group and a treatment group.
So then how does this apply? If there's no treatment in one of the groups, then you're saying that they would...
Yeah, there's treatments in both groups. There's something that makes them different.
Oh yeah, I guess.
Sure,
different treatment.
Yeah, they
okay.
Both have pretests and post-tests, but you know, the pretest goes for one group, pretest post-tests for the other.
Oh yeah. Okay.
Yeah. Okay. Okay. Wanted to just go over this, and then we'll do one other thing. Strength of our comparison group model, which is analysis of covariance, provides a method for adjusting observed post-test performance for random differences that may have occurred on the pretest. Remember, random differences, okay? When pretests differ across groups, okay? Weakness makes the assumption that the program and comparison groups are samples from a single population. In other words, there is no real difference in the population. And that is, you know, can the elephants beat the ants? And the test is this the difference between the adjusted post-test, the word is used, adjusted post-test mean for the program group, and the adjusted post-test mean for the comparison group. In other words, if you have pretest and post-test that differ, that analysis group is going to adjust those so that they turn out to be equal. Why? Because it was just sampling error, so, you know, the truth is that there is no difference here. So. I wanted to say something about quasi-experimental designs because they kind of fall into this area. It'll probably remind you of some things you've already thought of or are aware of because you've taken a course that has at least included this topic. Threats to validity, the extent to which a causal relationship is true. You may have seen these before. Historical events. Unrelated events concurrent with the program that contribute to the achievement of program goals. In other words, to what extent was your data affected by other things that went on in the environment. Those are usually things that you put in as covariates because they're messing up, so to speak, your data and they become a covariate, but they exist. Sesame Street, I was doing a study for AASD and some other schools combined, but they were studying the effect of Sesame Street on the amount in which kids could learn, because Sesame Street is very instructional in some ways. And they the kids, they would, interviewing, these were actually preschoolers and I think maybe first grade or something like that. They collected data on their how much learning that actually went on. The problem was that AASD did the study as to, in certain areas, certain subjects, and certain ideas that they used. It was apart from Sesame. They didn't use anything from Sesame Street. But they had an instructional program. It was the program that happens before program follow-through, teaching them certain sounds, certain words, and so forth. Okay, it turned out that that at the same time, you know, it was unbeknown to the people at AASD or the larger other schools in the surrounding area that were doing this, that the kids, Sesame Street was very popular this time. They, after school, run home and watch Sesame Street. Okay, and unbeknown to the school, the content that they were using, they were actually using from an archive from which Sesame Street got its content for preschoolers and first graders, okay? In which case, the study had to be stopped. It was found out that, hey, you know, these kids are finding these same vowels, same words, and so forth that were in this larger database. And that's an example about how historical events can disrupt your design. Maturation, a growth of participants as a function of time or increasing age. Example here, familiar with sick kids at home. The maturation, you know, you grow and you learn things and it happens, you know, whether you're in or out of school, certain things, you know, change. The growth of participants as a function of time, increasing age. Well, this was a case in which they examined sick kids at home. And there were sick kids that were home for an entire year. And they wanted to compare what they learned or didn't learn compared to kids that were in school at their same age and grade. Okay, you know, they had, you know, rather serious differences and problems in order to stay home a year. And they were astounded to find that the kids at home, the sick kids at home that stayed home for the better part of the year, knew more than the kids, their compatriots in the school at their same age and same grade. It was actually misused a little bit because people who didn't like school said, aha, it makes no difference whether you go to school or not. Okay, that wasn't the answer, but that definitely people use that against the schools, but a few people did. But what was going on? Well, if you have a sick kid at home, they investigated for, and a sick kid at home, that what are the, you usually have to have at least one parent home if that's the case. What do? You throw everything you have in terms of learning materials, games, and whatnot. And so the reason for that was basically that the change that actually occurred was the change that the parents actually did because their kid was at home, realized it, and that they were a teacher one-on-one. You weren't just a kid in a classroom with other 30 kids. You had the full attention of at least one person at home, and what do? You don't just walk around. You go buy things that are gonna get them to read, to explain, you know, explore things and so forth. So these are things that could mess up a study, okay, basically. Historical events, maturation, although that's kind of a bizarre case, the kid has to be home, you know, for a long period of time. But that was something that disrupted your design. Testing sensitization improves facility with post-test tests because of the familiarity with items on the pre-test. Well, maybe some of you have faced this, but you know, when you take a pre-test and a post-test, you're learning things from the pre-test that it is possible. These are two different tests, so you're taking the pre-test. You're learning things from the pre-test, maybe even test-taking skills to some extent, that could have an effect on the post-test. That's called testing sensitization. You pick up things, you item familiarity, in other words, especially if you happen to use some or all of the same items between pre-test and post-test. Instrumentation, another confounding event. Improving the facility with instrumentation. The effect of measuring program goals with pre-test and post-test is whose scores do not share an underlying common construct. Well, that's pre and post-test may not tap into the same construct. That has to do with test taking and test creating. It is easy to write items that are not consistent between pre-test and post-test. In other words, you could probably put some things in on the post-test that you really didn't teach, okay, and vice versa. That's instrumentation. You don't have a clear database for where you're drawing your information from. Statistical regression, well, one way or another, you've all heard about statistical regression. Basically, Francis Galton is the originator of that concept. What did he do? Francis Galton lived in England. He actually lived in London. Pretty smart guy, but he had an idea that, you know what? The taller you are, your parents are, the taller your offspring is going to be. The smaller you're, shorter your parents are, the shorter you're going to be. Kind of logical, isn't it? Believe it or not, he collected data in the parks of London for 2 years. Well, how did he collect the data? Well, the parks, been in London, they're beautiful parks, and people walk themselves. There's all kinds of walking on the weekends and so forth. It's filled with people and their kids, families go there. And then Sir Francis Galton actually, I don't quite know how he did this, but asked people whether he could measure them and their kids, okay? And collected all of his data for 2 years. And you know, okay, I guess he had a ruler of some sort. He measured the mother, the father, and the offspring, the kids, okay? Recorded the data, did it again and again and again, okay, over 2 years. It got confusing to him. He had all this data, and he said, you know, well, I'm expecting, you know, the taller the parent, the taller the offspring, but he couldn't, the pattern, there was just so much data. He didn't know how to put it together. What overall, what's the trend, you know, of it? And there was this weird guy at the end of the block that he lived in. He always seemed to deal with a lot of numbers. You know, he was like a number guy in some sense. I'm not sure how he knew he was, but he was a number. And he took his data and he went down and he said, you know, you seem to do a lot of statistics or something. He said, could you know, tell me what the trend of this is? And he took it in and he said, okay, I'll try to, you know, find out some way in which I could tell you what the results are here with all the data. And who was this guy? He invented now for Sir Francis Galton a special coefficient.
Pearson.
Pearson, right? His name was Pearson. Carl Pearson, okay? He developed the Pearson product moment correlation. You don't always hear the name before it, Pearson, but it's the correlation coefficient. And what did he find?
There was a correlation between parent height and then offspring.
There was a correlation, there's no question about that. But what was the correlation? Galton was on the idea that, we get the right people together, we can have a race of giants. But what did you find out? it's the reverse. The taller you get, the probability is less that your offspring will be smaller than you, and vice versa. Okay. So genetically, that was the result of it, not expected by Sir Francis Galton. But nevertheless, it's the law, it was first called the law of filial regression. Filial, it's a Latin word, means family. The law of family regression. But they called it the law of filial regression at that time. Okay. In other words, if you're very tall, the chances are your offspring is going to be smaller. If you're very small, chances are your offspring is going to be higher, taller. Not always, but generally. What's the correlation coefficient? I don't know. I don't remember it, but it was a significant correlation, but it probably wasn't real high. So that's statistical regression, just so you remember what that word means. Mortality. Well, that means people are going to drop out of your study. We're talking about threats to validity, okay? Well, mortality is, you know, hey, I'm in this study, and, you know, if the three of us have been talking about it, we're just going to get out of the study. Now, if it's not many people, that doesn't mean that it's going to inform your data too much. But the truth is they're going to be uneven in different groups that people drop out compared to those who remain. They may have certain characteristics. Finally, our group selection and effect on group differences due to the manner in which participants are chosen. You know, in some groups, you might have volunteers, other people. You might have to coerce to get into your study. How even you are in the group, you know, you can inadvertently have one group that people want to be in, so they have a certain nature, another group that isn't as exciting, okay? They say, well, okay, I'm doing a study, and which one group do you want to be in? Well, I want to be in this group because it sounds like it uses high technology and I'm a techie person or whatnot. And you, even though it's not directly what the program is doing, but it is an aptitude that could affect how you operate in there as opposed to someone else who doesn't. That's what they mean by that. This comes from the Campbell and Stanley people, but these are different designs, treatment and post-test. It doesn't control for any of these, okay? That's what these are here for, to see which of these designs can help us get through some of these threats to validity. Doesn't do any of them. One group, pre-test, post-test, it still leaves all of those at bay. And we come to randomized control group. Here we have T1 and T2, that's pretest and post-test. Here's the treatment, and here's pretest, post-test, no treatment. Remember, the history is maturation, test sensitivity, group selection, mortality. Those are the threats to validity, as Campbell and Stanley and some other people have pointed out. So here we're getting to what would you consider, can you use this for your dissertation? Yeah. Could you use the former two? Probably not. A fourth design is a randomized control group post-test only. And these are telling you what it controls for, and it does control for all of these because which may seem strange at first, because it's assumed that it's randomized. In other words, when we choose these subjects for the study, they're going to be random. It's going to be chosen randomly, so it doesn't affect the outcome. This is a non-randomized control group pretest design. Here, it's not going to control for all of these. It's going to history, maturation, and the testing effect. And for these are what's referred to as longitudinal designs, meaning that we give the pretest three times, we give the post-test at different times. So these are different intervals, basically. They're not all at once, you know, it's one month, next month, and so forth. There is no control group, and it does control for some, but not. It gives you, what it does give you is the serial, is there a serial effect? You know, how stable is your data pre and how stable is it post? That's basically the big question that a design like this answers. This is this very similar, except now, instead of just saying, how's my pretest, how stable is that, how is my post-test data stable, is, and then also, how does it compare with another group? In other words, this is my experimental group, this is my control group, and it then. These are designs that are time-consuming and costly. You don't see them very often, to be honest with you, especially when you have a design like this where you've got now two groups and you're waiting maybe a month between these. But what it's saying is, keep in mind that the real purpose of this is, how much is this moving around? In other words, does it go up for T1, way down for T2, D3? That should give you something to think about, because it's ruining your data, okay? You don't know what you're getting, and it could happen also here. So people do, when they reach new areas, and they're investigating new areas, that they tend to use these designs just to see, is the phenomena, how stable is the phenomena that I am now measuring, okay? Particularly when it tends to be a dependent variable that people have just put together and created for the first time, and we don't know how. So it can be very unstable, meaning that there's probably lots of things that are wound up in what you're calling a variable that isn't really consistent. And all this is just doing the same thing, but now with a control group or a different group that you're studying. Any parting thoughts? The takeaway that I'd like you to have is that you just had a verbal, very short description of our three approaches. And the reason for that is because you're going to hear their names out there. If you're in and around any kind of applied studies like evaluation studies. And you just have a working knowledge of it. Other people are going to implement these kinds of designs. You probably won't be around it very much. But just so you know something about our three design comparison group model, our analysis of covariance, and what did we call our first one? Norm reference, yeah. Okay, yeah.
When it comes to statistical power, and I know you, or it was effect size, and you know, statistical power, you need the three different, you need to consider the effect size, the N, and the whatever, the alpha. For the N, what is like considered in program evaluation? I guess like what's kind of like a standard in terms of like measuring? And I guess I'm just wondering like if you're evaluating a small program, and there's only 30 kids in the program, you know, like, can you run statistics on that, or does that have to be like mostly just a qualitative study? Or if you have a huge program, is there like a point when you don't want such a big sample size, and you don't want to, you know what I mean?
You don't need a big sample size. Well, two questions there. One is, you do studies all the time with 30. In it, there's nothing, you know. Now it depends on your random selection. How you got that 30 is very important. Okay.
What if it's everyone that's in the program?
Well, that's great, because then you have the whole population. You have no sampling error. If there's only 30 people that would ever use this, mm-hmm. It doesn't get to anybody else. You've got a perfect situation, don't you? Well, there's no error. You have differences among the 30 that are in there, but that 30 is the entire population.
Okay. At that point in time.
At that point in time. I 30 studies, it's not so much the N that you need to worry about, it's the homogeneity of it. I mean, N, obviously, as N increases, you increase, you know, you reduce your error, okay? You do. But it also has to do with the heterogeneity or homogeneity of these. If they're very different people, then you need a larger N, okay? And more N to then get the idea of, okay, what is basically in common among this large group, if anything? Those were good thoughts. So the normal reference to regression, the regression approach, and then finally our comparison group here with the analysis of covariance are three that will come up in name at least with you, and if you have some sense of it, you feel comfortable at least knowing what they do and their advantages and disadvantages. Any other thoughts? Yeah.
For our paper, are we proposing a method of analysis? Paper that we're
you
proposing.
Will in the third part of it. Now, that doesn't mean that you have to use what I've talked about today.
Right.
I mean, those
right.
are very legitimate
yeah.
alternatives, too. I mean, they're very common alternatives. But they do fit special circumstances, you know. I mean, analysis of variance. I didn't just talk about plain old analysis of variance in all its many forms. These were, you know, situations that evaluators run into. You wouldn't find a dyed-in-the-wool researcher going near these things, you know, and wouldn't know anything about them. But these were situations that are consistent with evaluation. You're going to be in situations that are going to, you know, you're going to at least hear these, and if not use, know that they're there. What, you had another issue though, didn't you? What were you?
Oh, no, just wondering.
Okay. We okay with everyone else? Well, you were asking about the presentations in the you should look back at first part of your paper. It's a work in progress, so you can change it and add to it. You know, maybe some of my comments helped, but your own intuition is good too. So you're gonna look at that first part. The second part of the paper is going to be our structured analysis and design technique, which we talked about last time. You're going to use that as a kind of an outline of the way in which you're going to put your program into that context, okay? And the reason for that is it's going to force you to look at certain things that are important to the program and its evaluation. Okay? It forces you to say, okay, what are the constraints? What are the inputs? What are the outcomes of it? What are the enabling outcomes? How do they connect with one another to make the program? My comment very much at the beginning of the class today would be is that the initial evaluations that occurred, which probably were more under the name of research, didn't look inside the programs. There was the beginning of the program, and there was the end of the program, and the end of the program was, you know, the measure that you thought the program was supposed to do. But how did you get that measure? Now, where are the transactions and the units of activity and their outcomes that got to that point? That's the big difference in program evaluation as opposed to research, right? Research says, I've got an experiment, I'm going to put you through the experiment, I'm going to get a post-test. The evaluator says, okay, we're trying to change people's behavior here. So you want something at the end of the program, post-test, to show good results, okay? Well, the only way you're going to get those, and this is what the researcher may not think about, is there's got to be units of activity in the program, which we call transactions, that have enabling outcomes that connect with one another to build upon one another to, in fact, give us a tangible look at how we got that outcome, okay? That first-order outcome. And what's the second order outcome in some follow-on environment to do? So, in essence, that line of thinking is very important to evaluation, whereas the researcher, say, I've got a pretest and a post-test, let me see if I'm different, but wait a minute, what was it in the program? Because I need to know what the change, okay? Programs don't operate miraculously the first time they're built, okay? You wanna say, okay, is this unit, and the evaluator wants to look at units of activity, maybe not all of them, but those that seem to be most important, or maybe possibly problematic or more complicated, and say, is this transaction producing an enabling outcome that is needed in order to get to the next step? Or do these units of activity come together to create this great, wonderful thing? At the end, what are those units of activity? In other words, they're transactions. They're active verbs, remember? I'm gonna teach this, I'm gonna provide that, okay? And the evaluator can go and look at any one of those to see whether they're real, okay? Yeah, if this transaction says it's doing this, I should be able to see that, and that may be part of my evaluation. You may not evaluate or look at all of those transactions, but they're there as a menu and saying, you know, I'm looking at the program and maybe we've got something that doesn't work here. So I'm going to now evaluate this transaction or that transaction and so forth and help build the program. So you see how much evaluators have really thrown themselves into the whole continuum of how you get inputs and outputs that you want. What's in between? What's the researcher doing? Not the denigrate research, okay? It has a different purpose. It's just looking for pretest and post-test, okay? And I got my post-test, okay. Maybe it wasn't too good, maybe the post-test was good, you don't know why, okay? Well, you know, because you named the program something, but what were the units of activity that could produce your outcome? And can we reproduce those units of activity in other programs like that? So it's much more inclusive. Research is theory driven, meaning that the proverbial P.05 level. Just to reiterate again, what does it mean? Well, it means that you could be wrong. You find something significant, you could be wrong 5 times out of 100, period. Well, tell me more. What more do you want? I can't tell you anything more, okay? I'm gonna tell you that the probability of getting this, you could be wrong 5 times out of 100. What's missing from the evaluator's point of view? Now, from the author's point of view, I got a P.05 level, and I'm gonna be able to get this published. It's a P.05 level and people like this, okay? And I said in my write-up that this was the program, okay? And this program produced that, okay? Well, that's fine, that's research. But what were the units of activity that actually led to that? Now, a lot of times, researchers aren't interested in what's in between. You know, it's like the pretest and the post-test. But not the program. But from an evaluation point of view, where money is being spent and people's lives are being used, students in classrooms and so forth, is that, wait a minute now, we've got to be sure that even more and more that what we're doing, it not only works, but it's ethical, meaning that, you know, people are supportive of it, that's our constraints. You know, are there people from the outside? Are things coming from down constraint? Saying that, whoops, this is community awareness is important or something of that nature could be in there. So it's much more inclusive than it is in research study. Okay, anything else? Okay, see you next time. We'll talk about qualitative, which is fun, and then we'll have two papers, presentations. I'll get the names of who wants to volunteer next time. Then after that, we have something called outcome evaluation, and then instrumentation. Instrumentation is, hey, what do you use for scales, checklists? What's the pros and cons of doing those? What kinds of situations do they fit? That's the instrumentation. Okay.